I'm Vin.
I'm Sori.
And we are doing the mainstream show. Woo! I don't know if we want to call it mainstream. We got the underground show. Opposite of underground is mainstream. Sori doesn't like the term mainstream.
I don't like mainstream. I don't like prime time. I don't know. Something fun sounding.
All right, we'll let you guys figure that out because all our good best ideas come from you. Okay, so we have so many good announcements to make. I'm so excited, but we're not going to make any announcement.
No.
Tool fans. we usually do an update video every Friday. So, like, I don't know if you've noticed, but that's our pattern. We release an update video.
I didn't realize that it was every Friday.
Yeah. We want you guys to be in the know. Think about it. The last time we shot an update video was when? Last Friday, when we went to go see the Avengers.
True.
Okay. So, we've got some very exciting announcements. But right now, we are doing some Devin Townsend.
I was listening to the other song we did by him. Was it called Kingdom?
Yeah.
Yeah. I listened to that one last night over and over in the car.
Did you really?
I did.
Where was I?
I was driving.
Oh, that's when you were out when I shot my sweet video. So thank you all, by the way, for saying that Sori's awesome. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks, guys. I really appreciated it, too. It was very surprising.
How'd you feel when you saw the video?
I cried. I was driving. Well, somebody, I looked at one of the comments and it said something that like kind of like tipped me off to be like, wait a minute, did he make a video? So then I went on the list and I like saw one with just him on it. I'm like, well, the one with us two. And I'm like, that is not like, I don't remember posting that. So I clicked on it and then I start watching it. I had to pull over because I was like crying. And then I keep seeing Sori is awesome on the things. And I was like, at first, when I first saw that, before I saw the video, I busted out laughing. I was like, somebody said Sori's awesome. And then he acted like he didn't know what was going on.
Well, people always take your sides in these debates anyway. So.
Well, they should. Yeah. They're on the side of truth. You can't help it.
All right. So
thanks, everybody.
Yeah, sure.
You guys are awesome, too.
Devin Townsend, I heard we're supposed to do the live version from Albert Hall. So here we are. And we're off.
We'll be right back.
Devin Townsend, ladies and gentlemen. He went from an underground guy to a mainstream guy. What's your thoughts? Right now, what do you think?
He's a deep brother, and he is a troubled man.
You think he's troubled?
I think so. Yeah.
What do you mean you think he's troubled?
I think that he has a lot inside of him. Like, people that feel stuff very, very deeply, they can't express it all out there because the world can't handle it. And I think he's the type of person that has a lot in there. And so he projects a certain thing out. And for the most part, I think that people are good with that, not actually seeing who he fully is.
Well, I mean, yeah, I mean, it's interesting because he's, you know, there are clips when he's like, pain! And he looks like a regular rock star who's in pain, and then he'll smile. You know, he's got this sort of lighthearted sort of, he projects a lot of lightheartedness, but, you know, there's a lot of people who, you know, this is armchair psychology, but there's a lot of people who project a certain type of, you know, ha ha ha, but inside they're in a lot of pain. You know, like Robin Williams probably,
right?
You know, the big, the big thing.
Yeah, we were just talking about that. Yeah. I remember I had watched Mrs. Doubtfire when I was a kid, and there was like certain parts of it where he was supposed to be making jokes, but his eyes looked so sad that I was confused because I thought, oh wait, this is supposed to be a sad part? And then I realized, no, the whole thing was supposed to be like a comedy, and there wasn't really supposed to be sad parts at the parts where it was so confusing to me. And then as I grew up, I realized, oh my gosh, like I was seeing more into him than he was trying to put out there. I mean, he was a comedy. He wasn't supposed to be putting out sorrow, but.
Well, yeah, Mrs. Doubtfire was about a divorce, and so those are always ugly as, you know, but.
Yeah, but there was parts where the camera would zoom in on his face, and you could see, like, in his eyes.
Yeah, I got to the point with me where I couldn't even watch any of his stuff, because I just knew. I knew something's wrong with him. But Devin, he's kind of like that. Like, you know, there were a couple unguarded moments in this video where like he would look down and whatever. Yeah. But then there are other times when like he became aware the crowd was looking at him. He did the regular Devin thing.
Yeah.
Lyrics are pretty straightforward. You are a sun goddess. Will you save me?
Why are you looking at me?
Because you're kind of like if there was like ever a human being who could like be a goddess and be like you, you know, you're just, just pay attention, like, you're just very, like, oh, sorry, you know, like, you're the type of person I could put on a shirt, but yeah, like, you're a sun goddess, will you save me, like, what do you think?
Well, I think that maybe he first is meeting this person or whatever, and there's, like, a lot of hopes that the person can say. Well, we've talked about this before.
Well, he's been married, I think, for 25 years. Some of our folks have.
Well, yeah, but maybe it was when he first met her.
Yeah. Maybe he wants her to continuously save him. You know, maybe she keeps him grounded, the whole rock star lifestyle and all that. Will you save me?
I don't know if he said, will you save me, or if he said, you save me.
It's, will you save me?
Well, that's what that is saying, but I didn't hear the will in there. But because it almost sounded like, I don't know, maybe I misunderstood, but it almost sounded like a little bit of like a mockery when he said, hooray for you, hooray. Like, you know how like a lot of times a woman like kind of wants to, oh, he's in a bad spot, let me try to help him and save him. And you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't know if he was actually meaning.
I think he meant it for sure. When he says hooray for you, you know, I don't think that negates that he really thinks that she can save him. I think a lot of people go to relationships thinking that, you know, this is a funny thing about, people, most of us have come to realize that we cannot get through this life by ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is the whole self-awareness thing, you know, what I feel like when you have people that say, I can do this all by myself, I think that is just demonstrates a complete lack of self-awareness.
You used to say that.
No, I didn't. I never said I can do it by myself.
You used to say that you could be fine being by yourself.
Yeah, I could be fine being by myself. That doesn't mean I can do life by myself. I need God. I need somebody. Oh, I'm talking about people who who say they don't need God, they don't need anything, they don't need anybody, they've got everything that they need within themselves.
Oh no, you never said that.
And I think that demonstrates a massive lack of self-awareness. I agree. And I think it's going to be controversial for sure, because, you know, we're America, you know? We're pull yourself up by your bootstraps, or even Western culture as a whole, because America was descended from Europeans or whatever. Western culture as a whole has this sort of, like, you know, post-enlightenment, you know, as long as I have enough knowledge or capital or land, then I'm self-sufficient. And I think one of the curious things to me about rock and roll is that there is this constant expression of need of other people.
Yeah, definitely.
And like even so, then I look at a guy like Devin Townsend. He's this big, giant, very successful rock star, and he still needs somebody to save him. And so in this, so my theory is that, you know, if you don't look to God to save you, you're gonna messianize, or you're gonna turn somebody else into your messiah save you from whatever hell that you have, whether it's loneliness hell or financial hell or whatever.
Yep.
You turn somebody into your messiah to save you from, you know, whatever thing that you need help with. So I think he's saying that she is the sun goddess, and he's looking to her to save him. When he says hooray, he kind of has this childlikeness about himself.
Uh-huh.
That I've only seen two of his stuff, and this is my first introduction to any of his stuff. But he kind of has this childlike attitude about things. So when he says hooray for you, I don't think that negates it. I just think it's his writing style of being kind of childlike. I'm like, hooray! Oh, okay. You know what I mean?
Now the rain, it comes, the rain, it blurs the gray line. If she's the sun goddess, then rain, I mean, generally speaking, there's not rain and sun at the same time.
Right. So when the tough times hit, it blurs the gray line.
The greyhound home?
Well, he says a gray line twice, and then he says a greyhound home. So I think that there are things that come in his life that undo the sun goddessness of what she helps him with. So like for him, I was thinking like, okay, so like the gray line, you know, you say like the lines are blurry, it's not black and white. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times that applies to certain moral decisions.
Yep.
So it's like, okay, what's right or wrong in this situation?
Mm-hmm.
And then it makes it hard to go home. That's interesting.
Sometimes there really is a gray, like, where you're, like, unsure. And sometimes it's black and white, but you don't want to believe it to be black and white, so you gray it.
Well,
you smudge the colors.
Yeah, and when I was looking at this, I was probably, you know, I'm probably making an assumption because he's a rock star. What I'm thinking of, because he's away from home.
Yeah.
What I'm thinking of is the stuff that happens on the road.
Uh-huh.
Or, like, if a bout of depression hits you on the road and then some girl comes onto your bus. And now, like, the line is gray, like, should I have this girl on my bus? Should I not? And then he falls into something, and then it makes it hard for him to go home.
Oh.
See what I'm saying? The gray line, and then it blurs the gray line home. And then the next line is...
Oh, my gosh, that's so interesting.
Then the next line is, you're so vicious, hurt me, I can take it, you know?
Like, as in vicious, as in his, you would say his girl is vicious, like, because she's angry? And so he's saying, hurt me, I can take it. Because you know how some people are like, just slap me in the face. Because I did something, you know?
Yeah. Because
they want to feel like...
I think it goes both ways, right? Like, because if she's staying with him, then she's basically saying, I can take it, you know? Because I've been in a relationship like that where they were doing all these terrible things. And I'm like, you know, I can take it. I'm strong enough to take it. And blah, 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 blah. So it could go that way. Or it could go the way you're talking about, where he does something. It's hard for him to come home. And then she says something really vicious to him, but he's like, well, I can take it. I shouldn't have done whatever it is that he did, right? Well, what are you thinking?
It's just sad, you know, like, just, but it, that's human nature. Like, we hurt each other, and...
Well, that's the thing about making a person, you know, a human being, all the pressure that you put on a person to save you in relationships,
mm-hmm.
you know, like... When you put that weight on just one human being, it becomes eminently suffocating and very destructive to the relationship.
Mm-hmm. I did that with you for a while.
Yeah.
Even just in our friendship. I was like, help me! Save me!
Save me!
You were like suffocating.
I was like, sorry, I need a minute to breathe.
I know. And then I would be like, oh, that hurts me! me?
Yeah. You don't love me. What are you talking about? I just spent 14 hours with you. I need to eat.
Yeah. Well, it was that water thing. Cereal. Like, to explain that water thing, you do so good at explaining it.
I do, but I'm saving that for a water song. This is not
okay, really all right, a water song. You'll have to be on the lookout for the water analogy. It's very good.
Yeah, so, like, you're gonna, you know, relationships, you're inevitably gonna hurt somebody, but if you put somebody in that category of your messiah, then you're gonna destroy them.
Yeah.
Because
yep.
You're gonna hurt them because we ultimately crucify our messiahs. Mm-hmm. So if you make somebody a messiah figure in your life, you're gonna crucify them. That's the principle. Mm-hmm. So... You know, you're going to hurt, but so, like...
Why? Why do we do that?
He uses words like vicious.
I know.
And hurt, and it's all in the heat of the moment, it's all in the pain. Mm-hmm. And that's pretty crazy. That's a pretty crazy line, because, you know, how many things get said in the heat of the moment?
Oh, I know. Yep.
And what's the line between saying, you know, when you apologize to somebody, you say it was in the heat of the moment. Like, is that honesty, or is that an excuse? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Or is it something of both?
Yeah, probably something of both, because I think sometimes there's things that you don't say because you're like, yo, I shouldn't say that, even though you kind of feel it. And then in the heat of the moment, it kind of comes out. But then, like, when you come back to your rational mind, you're like, yeah, I shouldn't have said that.
And then the next line is sonar again.
Yeah.
Sonar is interesting because, like, that's what you send out. It's a signal. Yeah. Like bats, like they don't see.
Right, they send out.
So they send out, you know, it's...
Sound, right?
You see through sound waves, right. Basically, mm-hmm. Is what sonar is. So that's an interesting line. But see, this is the thing about him. He'll say things like, hooray, which is very childish. Yeah. But then he'll say something extremely complex, because how does sonar again, fit into this whole conversation?
Well, maybe he's testing to see where she's at.
Right.
Where the situation's at.
Right, because that's what...
Maybe a phone call? Yeah. What is the sound of her voice?
Right. That's, you know? So good. Yeah. Because what do bats do? Like, that's how they see. Like, they send the waves out.
That's how they fly in the dark.
That's a wall. That's a, you know, so you throw those things out in the dark because you don't know where you are in the relationship.
Yep. Right.
So just...
first she was like the sun goddess. Then the rain comes.
Right.
And now he's talking about the seeing in the dark.
Sorry.
Oh, we missed it.
Okay.
I've always done that. I'm sorry.
Okay. So I'll be saying this for the rest of Vin and Sorry. That's so right. So she was a sun goddess, then the rain came, then the greyhounds thing happened. You know, the sun, rain, gray, and now it's black. It's dark. Mm-hmm. Now he's sending out sonars.
Yep.
And sonar again. So she has failed at being the sun goddess now.
And I would think sonar again, if you sent it out and you got a clear answer back, you would know where you're at. But if you keep sending it out, you're still keep checking.
That word again is important, though, because it's the cyclical nature of these relationships.
Yep. It's happened before.
Don't seem to be able to get out of those ruts.
Yeah.
You know, and I think we've been able to get out of ruts in the history of our relationship.
Yep.
You know, we've been able to
yep.
You know, and eventually, you know.
You've been extremely patient, though.
Eventually, we'll be sharing some of that, you know, personal stuff in a different forum and you know. If you want to glean something from it, go for it. But then at the song ends with, you are a sun goddess. Will you save me? Babe. And then the last thing he says is give in to the pain. So it looks like the cycle happens again. You know, like the sun is the most worshipped deity in human history. Right? Because we depend on the sun for everything, for light, for warmth, for food, crops, all that. So historically speaking, you know, all the way back from Egypt and all this, like the sun has been probably the most worshipped deity in the world.
Yeah, definitely.
So to call somebody a sun goddess is pretty high standard there. That's pretty impossible to live up to. Go ahead. What were you going to say?
Well, I was going to say, do you think because it's all in the heat of the moment, goes for the line before, which says, will you save me, babe? So and then he says, because it's all in the heat of the moment, because when you're in the heat of like the save me, like the love moment, so there's a heat of the moment there, which causes you to kind of forget the other stuff and kind of progress forward. But then it's all in the pain, like, so the heat of the moment also goes with the pain. You know what I'm saying? Like, it can be for both.
Yeah, and of course, the sun communicates heat. Mm-hmm. So the concept of the heat of the moment is a very ironic phrase because if she's the sun goddess, then you have these things called sun flares where they go, and they flash out. So I think the term sun goddess is sort of a double entendre because on the one hand she's nurturing, growing, that type of thing, but on the other hand she has these flares that flare up in the heat of the moment. And I think in the middle of the song you know why, especially with the gray line part, which makes me go You know, that type of lifestyle is extremely difficult to maintain and celebrate. I think he was, I don't know if he's divorced now or what. Devin Townsend, experts, help us out. I don't know, but it seems like it's very hard. And, you know, there's a lot of pain behind that. The last two songs that so Kingdom was about a relationship. He said, people have been, you know, informing us. The Kingdom song was about an apology.
Yeah, but I thought people keep saying it's like an apology to somebody that worked with him or something.
No, it was his wife.
Yeah, but some people keep saying that it's not his wife.
Yeah. Yeah, I heard that too.
But you don't agree with that?
I think it's probably, especially when I look at this song, it's probably a running theme for him.
Yeah.
But he's an amazing live performer. That middle part was...
Unbelievable.
That middle part...
voice, man.
That middle part was very, very unique. And I, you know, like, there was like one section and they were like continuously were playing this lick. And then, you know, it's weird because usually that's when the solo is supposed to come in, right? Yeah. But it wasn't new metal and it wasn't classical metal. And like, this guy seems to be kind of like his own...
Oh, yeah.
He's not a very... I mean, the last two songs I saw were not very complex musically. I thought that they were pretty, you know, basic musically. But he just does...
But like, he...
It's just big.
Like, yes, yes.
You know,
yeah.
Just big stuff.
And it's unique to him. Like, that's what I like about it. It's not like... Okay, from what you've shown me of all the other music we've listened to, nobody is like him. Like, some of the other songs, it kind of sounds similar. This guy, he's just completely unique. And and you really don't know what's coming next. Is he going to laugh next? Is he going to belt out some, you know, amazing vocal?
Yeah.
Or is he going to get, like, kind of like, you just don't know.
Yeah, he's definitely a one-of-kind, super talented guy. Apparently, this guy's been in, like, 50,000 bands.
Oh, really? He can't settle.
Well, I just think that he has so many artistic... He has got so much art in himself that he has to channel it out in different bands. Like, you could never do a song like this in Metallica or Korn. So you have to just basically jump onto another band so you can express that part of your part of your art form. And I think he's got so much art inside of him that he has to do.
Mm.
He has to do this. So, yeah, I like the song. I thought that the lyrics, I think, seem simple... But they're not simple.
Yeah.
And I think there's a major, major, major lesson about relationships we can learn from just this little
clip
there. So there you go. What do you rate the song?
9, actually.
9.
Yeah. I just love him. I love him. I love the way that he puts music out. I love how he's an individual and he's not, I don't feel like he's trying to steal anybody's idea. He's just being himself and I love that.
Yeah, it's a 7.5 for me.
Well, how come now 7.5? What happened?
What do you mean what
happened? What's like kind of brought his score down?
Well, it's not. It's just the musicianship is very basic.
Oh, you like some complexity and
well,
stuff.
Well, no, I mean, if you're going to give it a 10, if I give it a 10, like this is something you put in a vault and then you open it up 40 years from now
and
it's
still
just
well,
as relevant.
Well, I didn't give it a 10. I gave it a 9.
Yeah. Yeah, I didn't think there was anything particularly standout-ish about the music. I didn't think there was anything that, you know, I thought the lyrics were, I gave it a 0.5 for the depth of the lyrics. There wasn't a lot of, and he's not Maynard James Keenan, and he's not Danny Filth, but I did think that for the common man, that if you studied what he was saying in this song, that you could get a ton out of it. So he got 0.5 for that. But, you know, I thought... I didn't want to give him an average score because I don't think it was average because I enjoyed the music. But I, you know, once you start getting in that 8, 9, 10 range with me, you
really would know.
It's something memorable and special. I'm going to forget the musicianship after we shut this thing down. So, anyway, that's it. All right, y'all. Devin Townsend. Stay tuned for the Underground show coming very, very soon tonight. We have a short list of underground bands because I wanted... So here's the thing. We are going to do Opeth, Ghosts of Perdition very, very soon. The issue is I want to get through... The underground show's underground for a reason. So we got to get through all these bands that are not getting any burning underground. So Meshuggah, There's this band called Hurt, somebody was talking about. There's this band called Tesseract.
Alice in Chains, I don't know.
Alice in Chains is a very famous, huge band. They're not an underground band.
Oh, okay.
The problem is that they're like 90s grunge. They're like stuck in the Nirvana age. All the Alice in Chains fans are mad at me. Oh. So yeah, we could put them, they're on the underground list, but they're not really an underground band, okay. Right? Like, so we've got, there's this operatic metal Camelot. So I really want to make sure that in the underground show, we're getting underground stuff. While at the same time, we got to continue the Opeth journey. Mm-hmm. And the Porcupine Tree journey, because all the Porcupine Tree fans are saying, You shouldn't have done Halo! It was the worst one! You know what I like about Porcupine Tree fans? We didn't really give Porcupine Tree a very high score. No. We were both like, And you know what? Pretty much to a man and a woman, all the Porcupine Tree fans were saying, wasn't their best stuff.
Yeah.
And I appreciate that. Because you got some people from some bands that I'm not going to mention their names that if you don't give their band like a high score, even if they're on an off song, they're like, every single song in your catalog for the last 18 years has been a hit. Come on, man.
Let's be honest.
So, Porcupine Tree fans, you guys are going to get a double spin on Underground just for your honesty. And I appreciate you.
Cool. I like that.
But we got to get through all these other bands first. Because we've had a ton of, like, repeat, you know, I'm very tempted to do the Opeth again and all the rest of it. But we've got to stay committed to the Underground ethos. And the Underground ethos is bands that are not getting reviewed, not getting exposed.
Those are the ones we want.
We're committed to make sure we're doing it.
That sounds like a good idea.
That's why we do 2 shows a day. Mm-hmm. All right, good. Stay tuned. We've got an update coming for you. I promise you, you're going to be very excited. Are you excited about all the stuff that's going to be happening?
Oh, my word. I'm wicked excited. You have no idea.
Yeah.
I keep saying it. I'm like, can't you get off work early so we can...
Stop telling them. Stop telling people. Sun Goddess, Vin out.
Story out.
Telling people our secrets, man. This is a problem. Stop telling people our secrets.
No, you're going to have to. You told me to speak freely.